Okay, we're going to get started. Again, welcome to today's webinar. My name is Chris Lilienthal. I am the Communications Director with the Pennsylvania Budget and Policy Center, and I'm very pleased to kick things off this afternoon. Our webinar today is an update on the healthcare front here in Pennsylvania, which will include a look at the governor's healthy PA plan, the issue of Medicaid expansion, and the latest on the health insurance marketplaces that opened up a month ago today here in Pennsylvania and across the nation. I just wanted to note that this webinar is being recorded this afternoon. We will post it on our website a little bit later this afternoon in case you want to go back and watch anything or share it with friends and colleagues. At this point, I am going to kick things over to Sharon Ward, who will start us off today and introduce our lineup of speakers. Sharon?
Terrific. Thanks very much, Chris, and thanks everybody for joining us today. We're here to talk healthcare. When the Affordable Care Act was passed, it envisioned comprehensive health coverage for nearly all of America's uninsured, and that included really two major provisions on the access side. One was an expansion of Medicaid coverage for adults without children and individuals with incomes up to 138% of the federal poverty level, and private market insurance through exchanges for other individuals and individuals in small group plans. When the Supreme Court decided to uphold the Affordable Care Act, it also unexpectedly made the Medicaid expansion a key component of coverage, a state option. So as of this month, 25 states and the District of Columbia are moving forward with a Medicaid expansion and 25 are not. All of Pennsylvania's neighboring states, New Jersey, New York, West Virginia, and Maryland, are relatively early deciders around accepting the federal Medicaid option. And last week, the last of our neighboring states joined that group, and Ohio, where Medicaid expansion had been championed by Governor John Kasich, did make the decision to go ahead with a Medicaid expansion. Here in Pennsylvania, despite a robust effort in our state, the General Assembly was not able to enact legislation authorizing a Medicaid expansion. Although the move had wide support, it ultimately fell short. It passed the Senate by a vote of 40-10 in late June, but failed in a very dramatic procedural vote in the House in late June. Thanks to all the good work that has been done by healthcare advocates across the spectrum, on September 16th, Governor Tom Corbett has announced his intention to advance a comprehensive healthcare initiative that's called Healthy Pennsylvania, and we'll hear about that today. That initiative has a number of components. Some of them have already moved forward, but central to that plan is a coverage expansion proposal that would not expand the current Medicaid program as we know it, but instead would exercise an option that is permissible and under the Affordable Care Act to provide premium support for individuals to purchase insurance on the health insurance exchange. And the proposal, as you will hear today, also includes changes to eligibility and benefits for existing Medicaid beneficiaries. So what we'll cover today is really three things. We'll hear about the details of the Healthy PA plan, questions and implications for consumers. We'll hear about a timetable for implementation of that plan. And then we'll hear a little bit about what that means, what this decision to move forward with Healthy PA and the premium expansion rather than Medicaid expansion means for individuals on January 1st, 2014. And then we will get back and talk a little bit about issues of enrollment of the federal exchange. We all know that there's been a great deal of coverage about the challenges that are associated with the federal website. So what we'll do today is hear more about the other options that people have for enrolling. The website that is the portal for people who are in federally facilitated exchange states, like Pennsylvania, has been problematic. But the website is not a program, it's a website, and the Affordable Care Act has stressed a no wrong door approach, so we can talk a little bit about the other avenues to enroll in Medicaid, CHIP, or the exchange. So we're going to kick it off today with Laval Miller-Wilson. Laval is the Executive Director of the Pennsylvania Health Law Project. PHLP is counsel to the Consumer Subcommittee of the state's Medical Assistance Advisory Committee, and that Consumer Subcommittee has a seat at the table where decisions will be made and has a very important role to play. And after Laval, we'll hear from Erin Gill Neinhauser, who is one of the most knowledgeable people in the state about the details of the Affordable Care Act. She has given probably 200 presentations and knows all 2,000 pages of the Act backwards and forwards. She understands the provisions, but also their implications for Pennsylvanians. She is the Outreach and Education Director for the Pennsylvania Health Access Network and a key staff member for the Cover the Commonwealth campaign. So let's start with Laval.
That's great. Thanks very much, Sharon. I hope everyone can hear me. I have the privilege of directing the Health Law Project, the Pennsylvania Health Law Project, and as Sharon noted, we have been counsel for the Consumer Subcommittee, a group that represents the 2.2 million Medicaid consumers that rely and are dependent on the Medicaid program. I wanted to take about 25 minutes to go through the Healthy Pennsylvania proposal. It's a concept paper that the governor introduced in mid-September to describe some of its implications for reforming the Medicaid system. Healthy Pennsylvania has a lot of ambition to improve Pennsylvanians' health. The parts that we want to focus on are around some of the reforms that have been proposed for Medicaid. What I want to describe, to make sure, before getting into Healthy Pennsylvania, we want to make sure that you understand Medicaid, and I'm going to take some time to go through Medicaid basics, then get into the provisions of Healthy Pennsylvania by describing the details that have been released to date, some of the concerns that have been raised by advocates, and then describing the stakeholder process. It is a the stakeholder process, just jumping to the end for a moment, is Healthy Pennsylvania is a concept. It's been described and proposed by the governor, but there are many, many details that need to be reviewed and worked out, and ultimate approval has to come from the federal government in order to implement some of the changes that you're going to hear about. So we're, again, this is more in concept form. We're going to be hearing more details, but I want you to hear a bit about the broad brushstrokes. I'm not going to be able to get into too much detail about the legality of some of the proposals. There are some concerns that we have around it violating Medicaid law, violating the Affordable Care Act. Those are details that I'm not going to get too far into the weeds. We just want you to make sure you have an understanding of the proposal and the concepts. So Medicaid basics. Medicaid, as many in the audience probably know, Medicaid is also called medical assistance in Pennsylvania. It's the federal state health insurance program for low-income children, families, persons with disabilities, and the elderly. I'd remind folks, again, that Medicaid, as it exists right now, is a poor plus program. When I say that, it's poor and you have to fit into a certain category. Medicaid is determined by categorical eligibility in Pennsylvania still. So you have to be poor and a child, poor and a caretaker for a child, poor and a person with disability, poor and elderly. If you're poor, you don't have an opportunity generally to get Medicaid. That's the that is how the Affordable Care Act has this opportunity to change. But as Sharon noted at the outset of our webinar, the Supreme Court made that expansion optional. Getting back to how it works in Pennsylvania currently, it's run by the Pennsylvania Department of Public Welfare (DPW). We spend with the federal government a tremendous amount of dollars on our Medicaid program. roughly $18.7 billion. And it's good value. It provides a broad array of health and long-term care services that aren't typically covered by private insurance. And when I say that, the types of services that we're talking about are nursing home care, home health care, and also Medicaid is concerned about, for low-income people, just having the access card isn't enough, and sometimes you need to be able to get to the doctor. So it provides some wraparound benefits, we call them. Getting to the doctor is some of what Medicaid provides. Not everyone needs that. Only about 9% of Pennsylvanians that are on Medicaid need some additional help in getting to the doctor. But if you live in a rural part of the state and you have difficulty affording transportation to get 30, 40, 50 miles out to the doctor, Medicaid is there to provide some assistance. So those are examples of some of the benefit packages. Now, before getting into Healthy PA, I think it's pretty important for folks to understand how medical assistance, Medicaid, is managed. The federal government contracts with DPW, the Department of Public Welfare, and DPW in turn contracts with private health insurance companies. We call them Medicaid Managed Care Companies, and in our state it's called the Health Choices Network. Those are private health insurers that administer the program. Now they're driven, some are nonprofit, but whether you're a nonprofit or for-profit, you still take a risk, and there's some profit motives and incentives that affect their decision making. We have 2.2 million Pennsylvanians in the Medicaid program, and about 1.5 of them are in the Health Choices system. The network that's available for Medicaid recipients, they're able to go to any participating doctor. Not all doctors participate in the Medicaid program, sometimes because its rates are a bit too low. And also Medicaid recipients are limited in some ways. When you join a Medicaid managed care program, you're limited in terms of the choices that you go to that are a part of that health insurance plan. We have an abundance of health programs that of health insurers that participate in the Health Choices Medicaid Managed Care Program in Pennsylvania. We have, I think, as many as 8 that participate in different regions around the state. Now let me shift over to Healthy Pennsylvania and the priorities. Understanding how the Medicaid system works right now and describing how the Medicaid relevant provisions of what the governor would like to do. And there are basically 3 aspects to the governor's proposal. He's attempting to improve access. He's trying to ensure quality of the folks that do have a card coverage. And he's trying to make sure that it's affordable. These really don't differ too much from the tenets of the Affordable Care Act. The governor's proposal can be viewed through basically two lenses. One piece that the governor is trying to do is to reform the Medicaid program. And he will walk through some of these details, but in broad brushstrokes, the governor's suggesting that that we align current Medicaid benefit programs with private and commercial health insurance. Second, he's trying to ask individuals that are Medicaid beneficiaries to take more responsibility of their health and to participate in more cost sharing, paying more in terms of premiums, and we'll describe more about that. And then also the governor is suggesting that to be a part of the Medicaid program, at least for adults, that folks participate in job training and work search. That's the first part of reforming the Medicaid system. These are areas that go before he'd like to reform the Medicaid system before he gets to the second part. The second part is saying, I want to increase access for the uninsured by using the private option to enroll newly eligible uninsured adults in the private health insurance marketplace. So the governor's proposal is to improve the current current Medicaid program, and then to say for the new eligibles, I actually don't want to use the Health Choices program. I want to put them in the private health insurance marketplace that's operated by the federal government. So let's go through some of these, and I want to present the details and then raise some of the concerns that many advocates have raised and are waiting to hear more about the governor's proposal. The first piece is changes to the existing Medicaid benefit program. The governor's main interest here is saying we need to reform because there are too many differing adult benefit packages. We have as many as 14 different benefit packages, and the governor would like to consolidate those packages into essentially two for adults. Children would be unaffected, but the next two pieces that you can see on the slide, there would be basically taking adults and putting them into a high-risk group and a low-risk group. The high-risk group is for medically frail adults, adults that are high utilizers of services, adults that have chronic acute conditions or chronic care conditions. Those would be high risk, and there would be a benefit package for them. There would also be a benefit package for adults that are not high utilizers. That's the low-risk package. The benefits have not been spelled out in much detail yet. In terms of low risk, the benefit would be essentially like the essential health benefits that's in the exchange or the marketplace now. For the high risk group, it's generally seen as it wouldn't change the Medicaid benefit package too much. In fact, and I'll get into federal law just briefly here, is that it doesn't really appear that a state is permitted to take that high risk group and put them in the marketplace. That group has to be given a choice of either going into the marketplace or staying in the current Medicaid system that we have. Here's some of the concerns that have been raised, and I'm just highlighting some of them and not all. Some of the concerns that have been raised about this proposal about adjusting the benefit package, consolidating, are what's the standard and what's the process for assessing who's high risk and who's low risk? It's not clear from the proposal, the concept paper, what instrument, what measurement is going to be used to assess high risk and low risk. And the other piece that is very much on folks' mind is with regard to cost savings. What are the cost savings with this arrangement of high risk versus low risk? Is this really going to save the Commonwealth money? There's much concern about if you take a person and you put them in low risk and suddenly they become sick, how quickly can they get into needing more services? Does that mean they have to immediately leave the essential health benefit package that's in the marketplace and then go back into the regular Medicaid system? Those questions are really unanswered at this time. And we'll all be watching pretty carefully for more details about these benefit changes. Here's a second area that comes up in terms of the Healthy PA proposal and its Medicaid changes. The governor would like to go ahead and say we'd like to add a Medicaid premium for the cost of that coverage. And it looks something like this. It would be a sliding scale premium, a sliding scale meaning it's adjustable. And this would again apply only to adults and not to kids. So adults with incomes between 50% and 133% of federal poverty would be charged a premium, again on a sliding scale. So the sliding scale would mean at a minimum it would be $25 per month up to $35 a month. It's not clear what the sliding scale is other than those two ranges, a minimum of 25, no higher than 35. And in terms of the poverty, you'll see the slide that shows what that means for an individual. At 50% of poverty, if you're an individual, that's $5,745. At 133% of poverty, it's $15,282. we're talking about very low-income folks. It's not clear that they can afford even this much in terms of the premiums. I'm getting ahead of myself a bit, but those are in terms of the concerns, but that's the proposal that's been laid out of let's have a sliding scale premium. Now, those premiums under the governor's concept paper would say we can reduce those premiums from 25 or 35 per household to a lower amount, and it's not clear how much lower, whether it would get to zero, but that can be based on two pieces. One, whether an individual is engaging in preventive activities, engaging in tobacco cessation programs. The governor hasn't been all that clear about what that means for preventive activities, but that's an example that could come up. And work search. If an individual is searching for work, then that could reduce the premium. The concerns with the sliding scale premium is, well, are you charging all adults with this sliding scale premium? And then there are some adults where folks are very vulnerable, pregnant women, persons that are medically frail with challenging health conditions, dual eligibles, which are folks that are eligible for Medicaid and Medicare that are seniors, elderly, or have, again, medically frail issues. Do they have to go with the sliding scale premium? It's not clear at all how the premiums are going to get collected. Who's going to be collecting them? Is this the governor's responsibility or DPW's responsibility? Is this the health insurers? What happens if they're not paid? And then in terms of the work search requirements, again, this is a fairly heavy topic. We could spend 30 minutes going about work search, but in broad strokes, it's who's tracking the individual participation in work search? How is work search defined? Is it registering on a website? Is it proof of showing applications that have been made? What's required? Same kinds of concerns around tracking participation in preventive health activities. Who's responsible is it for participating? Are we measuring quality performance? Are we saying you need to get your cholesterol level lowered, or it's enough to register for with a dietitian? And if that's the case, in the latter, a dietitian is a health insurer providing that service. Is that an essential benefit? So those are lots of questions around some of the sliding scale premiums, and we just don't know yet how Pennsylvania is going to implement this. Here's a second issue that comes up, and this one isn't quite as challenging as the first two, changing existing Medicaid premiums. With regard to the governor's proposal, the proposal is to go ahead and say we want to eliminate copays for adults. Again, children are not going to be affected. Children do have some amount of copays. But for adults, the governor's proposal is to eliminate all copays except for non-emergent or non-urgent use of an emergency room or emergency department. Now, this is a welcome proposal. Research has shown that copays lead low-income individuals to foregoing medically appropriate care. There's also lots of details that are hard to implement in asking consumers to pay. Who's asking for it? Is it the doctor and the insurer? Who's chasing? But the research, again, is just showing people that are asked for copays end up foregoing care that they should be receiving. And we don't want that. The question that comes up here is, so that's a welcome proposal. The issue that remains is for the emergency department care, who's going to be determining and how the inappropriate use of an emergency department? We're just not clear about how that's going to play out just yet. The last piece about the Healthy PA proposal is with the expanding the new population. And those are the first three that I was describing are reforms to the existing Medicaid population. That's the first three components of Healthy PA. Again, reforming the Medicaid system right now. And then saying, okay, if we get that, we'd like to go ahead and expand the population. And that involves placing them not in the health choices system, but putting them into the health insurance marketplace. there is, in using that, all ACA-eligible individuals, again, adults, who are not medically frail, would be enrolled in the marketplace, and they'd be asked to pay a premium. And in terms of how the money would work, the federal government would pay 100% of the cost for these individuals to be in the private health insurance marketplace, minus the cost of the premiums that the individuals would be paying. And then in 2017, the state would need to start to begin to pay its mandated share, which, as folks may well know on this call, is not the federal government is paying the great percentage of the cost for each individual, even when the state begins to pay its share in 2017. There's lots of questions around the private option that we don't have time to get into. We really don't know whether the commercial carriers that are operating on the private health insurance marketplace are interested in this population, want to care for this population. There hasn't been a lot of comment from that sector made yet. We don't know yet from providers whether providers are interested, although the providers may say we're interested in this particular option because Medicaid doesn't pay high rates, and we know we can get higher rates on the private side. But again, there has been generally silence so far, at least public comment, from those two sectors about this this aspect of the private option. A couple additional thoughts and concerns about the governor's proposal overall. Even if you put, and especially if you deal with putting folks from the Medicaid side into the marketplace, the Department of Public Welfare still is responsible for making administrative and policy decisions for the program. So essentially what that the department needs to be aware of, and the Commonwealth and the federal government needs to understand, is just because you're taking folks that are uninsured and using Medicaid-sourced dollars to put them in the private marketplace, DPW still has a responsibility to make sure that they are, that the rights of these Medicaid-eligible folks are still enforced. It can't say to the insurance department, you measure it, you figure it out. DPW is the sole entity that's responsible for the Medicaid funds that the federal government sends, and it has to take ownership and accountability. And we know the federal government is requiring that of every state. It's agency that runs the Medicaid program. So it's not quite off the hook, and we really don't know how this is going to play out in terms of the administration of state government. A second piece that is also related and just really just as important is if you're a consumer and you have Medicaid-sourced dollars flowing into the private marketplace, you have additional rights that other folks on the marketplace don't. It may be a similar benefit package, but if you disagree with the benefit that the insurer is saying you can't have, and sometimes that happens, in many cases, Medicaid consumers have the right to appeal in the marketplace, or sorry, in the Medicaid side. They have the right to go ahead and go to an administrative law judge to have that judge be the arbiter. That doesn't exist on the private health insurance side. You can go to a plan with a grievance, but you can't go to an administrative law judge. But one state that was given permission to put their new eligibles in the marketplace, Arkansas, federal government insisted that that state say to its folks that are in the marketplace, well, if you take Medicaid money, you have to make sure they have a right to appeal. Those are things that may, again, we'll have to see how that plays out, and we'll have to see whether insurers on the commercial side are comfortable with that additional right that comes for the Medicaid consumers. Let me just say one and a closing about this part about Healthy PA, just the process, the timetable for the Healthy PA application. And this is going to be a little bit weedy, but it's basically the federal government will accept Pennsylvania's proposal if it does it through what's called a Section 1115 waiver application. And let me just say a little bit about what that means. The federal government can give permission to states to administer their programs if a state is saying, we want to do something experimental or a pilot or a demonstration that doesn't change Medicaid too much, but it's Pennsylvania is a little bit different from New Jersey or Ohio. And the federal government has given permission for states to do changes for their Medicaid program. These are, it's called Section 1115 demonstrations. And they typically last for 5 years, and they can get renewed. And this is, the governor's proposal has elements of what was approved in Arkansas, although not necessarily the work search requirement, and other aspects are a little bit different. But the federal government has given states permission to expand. But it doesn't happen just because the governor and governors want to do so. They have to really negotiate with the state around this, or the federal government has to negotiate, the state has to negotiate with the federal government to make this happen. And let me tell you a little bit about the public input process that is going to work at the state level. Before submitting to the federal government, states have to solicit meaningful public input. So that means that Pennsylvania is going to have to show a lot more details about these concepts and really spell out what they mean. And they're going to have to release that publicly and give folks at least 30 days to provide comments before Pennsylvania even submits that to the federal government. So the state of Pennsylvania is going to notify the public by having public hearings, and the state has already said they're going to have at least 2 hearings. They're going to circulate the information through notices, electronic email lists, through a state website. That's what Pennsylvania has to do before it submits comments to the federal government. And then public input at the federal side is also lengthy. First, once the federal government receives Pennsylvania application, it needs to make sure everything's there, including the public comments that are in. And then the federal government has its own 30-day public comment period where it asks for comments from folks across the country and definitely Pennsylvania residents. Hey, what do you think? What do you think we should consider? We're interested in your comment. So it's not just a rubber stamp of the state submits and gets public comment and then the federal government doesn't take any input. There's a lot of opportunity for federal input, input to the federal government. So I raced through, in some ways, the piece on Healthy PA, but those are some of the high-level changes that are coming up. And Sharon and Chris from Budget and Policy, I think we'll take an opportunity to see if there are questions, whether those are written or whether folks want to go ahead and ask questions. And as we're seeing some questions come in, again, the timetable is, it's not clear. The state government has said, we're eager to do this as soon as possible. And we'd be willing to expand Medicaid, do the reforms starting January 1st of 2014 if the federal government gave us permission to do so. But we know these details are not that easy to iron out. For the reasons that I've been describing before. So it's really unclear where the timetable is going to lie. Arkansas took about a year and a half to go through their negotiations with the federal government. We can build on Arkansas's experience, but that doesn't, and so it may not be a year and a half, but it's not as easy as copying Arkansas and laying the imprint on Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania has a much bigger Medicaid program. It's a different population. And so it's just not as easy as saying, well, that was done in one state, why don't we apply it here?
Well, I'm not seeing any questions come through, so you must have done a very thorough job, Laval. but Laval will be sticking around with us, so if you have any questions as the presentation goes on, he will be here with us at the end to answer any questions you have. So at this point, I'll just pass it on to Aaron Neinhauser, who is going to discuss a little bit more about Medicaid expansion and the potential coverage gap that will exist in Pennsylvania if we don't take steps to make that a reality. Aaron?
Thank you so much, Chris, and thanks, Laval, for that great and very thorough overview, bringing us to where we are at this point. So we will go to the next slide here. So what does this all mean for Pennsylvanians come January 1st? As Sharon said at the beginning, the Affordable Care Act intended for anyone who earns below 138% of the poverty level to have been covered by Medicaid. And expecting that that would happen, the Affordable Care Act set tax credits to start at 100% of the federal poverty level. And this graphic right here shows how that plays out. When the Supreme Court upheld the law and made Medicaid expansion optional, it didn't go back in and fix the fact that technically for anyone that earns below 100% of the poverty level, those folks are not eligible for subsidies to buy coverage in the marketplace. So practically speaking, what that means is that for a single person, if you earn below about $11,500, for a couple, if you earn below $15,510, for a family of three, if you earn below $19,500, or for a family of four, $23,500 for the year, you are not able to get tax credits to get a plan in the marketplace, and you also will not be able to qualify for Medicaid, you know, because Pennsylvania's current rules for qualifying are still in place, and qualifications weren't eased through Medicaid expansion until we do that here in Pennsylvania. So, you know, this is a very serious situation for folks in this gap, and I want to go on to the next slide, and let's see here. If Pennsylvania fails to act or delays action for a year, there are, you know, there were two different estimates on how many folks are stuck in this gap, you know, people that earn below 100% of the poverty level. One conducted by the Urban Institute from late 2011 found that there were about 398,000 folks in this gap. A more recent one that actually just came out last week by the Kaiser Family Foundation found that about 281,000 Pennsylvanians are in this gap. But either way, that's a lot of people who could potentially be left out in the cold with no real good options for coverage come January 1st. And obviously the Affordable Care Act intended for Medicaid expansion to happen in all states starting January 1st, 2014. So, you know, the delay and any delay in getting the details of, you know, Health EPA worked out and approved, you know, lots of folks are going to suffer for that delay. So that's a big concern for us. One very important thing to understand, and I've, as Sharon talked about, I've given lots of presentations and been talking to folks in all corners of Western Pennsylvania just about how the Affordable Care Act works and what families and small businesses need to know. But one of the biggest questions that I get from folks is, you know, will I be penalized if I can't afford insurance? And so it's very important to stress that if you live in a state that chooses not to expand Medicaid or they haven't expanded yet but might in the future, if you would have been eligible and your state hasn't expanded for whatever reason, you will not have to pay the penalty for continuing to go uninsured. So that's very important to understand. Anyone, any of these, you know, 281,000 folks that are stuck in this gap in Pennsylvania will not be penalized if they continue to go uninsured in 2014. And there's also an important income exemption for anyone. So if you cannot find health insurance costing less than 8% of your annual income, you are also exempt from paying the penalty for those, you know, who go uninsured. And that's whether you are offered coverage through your employer or whether you live in a state that doesn't expand Medicaid or for any other reason. And that's very important to remember, so I'll just repeat it. You know, if you can't find health insurance that would cost less than 8% of your annual income, you're exempt from paying the penalty. And of course, the penalty, the first time the penalty is paid is when we're all filing our income taxes in 2015 for the year 2014. And so if you've gone uninsured in 2014 and you wouldn't have had a hardship buying insurance, then you would pay either $95 or 1% of your taxable income, whichever is greater. One other very important thing to understand is that for folks that do have a financial hardship affording health insurance, so if you would have been eligible for Medicaid and your state hasn't expanded, or if you meet this 8% threshold and can't find insurance that would cost less than that, you would have the option to buy a catastrophic plan in the marketplace. And a catastrophic plan would cover three primary care visits and preventive care with no copays or cost sharing. So, you know, that's a last resort option, but it's certainly not the level of coverage that the Affordable Care Act intended. So we're just working to make sure that, that folks know that, that it, at least that is available. And in addition to that, certainly community health centers will continue to play a very important role to continue to provide primary care and a lot of other important services to folks that are in this gap. So we'll go on to the next slide here. So how do we make Medicaid expansion happen in Pennsylvania? This is something that lots of organizations have been working very hard on. As Sharon talked about at the beginning and as we've all talked about, this is an issue that has a lot of bipartisan support and a lot of support from people across the board, you know, hospital executives, healthcare providers, chambers of commerce, advocates for the uninsured, community organizations, churches. This is one of those issues where everybody's really on the same team and working to get this done because the benefits in terms of coverage are very substantial. But also, there's a huge economic benefit for Pennsylvania. We could create up to 35,000 good-paying jobs, grow our economy by billions of dollars each year. So this is a really important issue, both on the health side, but also on the economic side. So what we've been working to do through the Cover the Commonwealth Coalition, which is over 100 organizations working together to make Medicaid expansion happen in Pennsylvania, is continue to collect and raise up stories of folks who would qualify for Medicaid expansion. You know, most of the folks that I've met that qualify for Medicaid expansion are working, but they're working either part-time or, in a service sector kind of job that doesn't come with health insurance. Across the state, 75% of the folks that will qualify for Medicaid expansion have at least one full-time worker at home, and many are already working themselves. So as we meet folks, and if you work with an organization or you care about this issue, talk to friends and family, talk to folks in your organization and in your community, and especially if you're doing outreach and education about the Affordable Care Act and helping to get the word out and helping folks connect with navigators and certified application counselors, when you meet people who would fall into this coverage gap if their income is below 100% of the poverty level, encourage them to share their story in the media through a letter to the editor. Encourage them to call their state representative and state senator to share their story and say, look, I thought I was going to be covered next year. What are you doing to help make sure that this is resolved as quickly as possible so that I don't have to struggle through another year uninsured? So that's what we've been working to do, and we're happy to work with you or your organization through the Cover the Commonwealth campaign to plan local events in your community, to help you outreach and communicate with your local lawmakers, and to really keep this issue alive in the media. That's so important to make sure that we keep the pressure on. And I think the fact that we've had so much bipartisan support and so many different organizations working on this has brought us to the point where the governor came out with his Healthy PA plan and is starting to move the ball forward and get this resolved. Okay, so that's all I was going to talk about today, but I'm happy to take questions, and certainly we're here as a resource to help folks that are in this gap figure out how to make sure that you're getting, primary care through a health center or possibly a catastrophic plan, but most importantly, sharing those stories so that we do get this resolved very quickly.
Hi, folks. Back one more time just to talk a bit about how the health insurance marketplace has played out. And we could do a whole webinar, and there's been even hearings about this in Washington, D.C., testy hearings about the marketplace. What we wanted to do was just share a bit about some of the workaround solutions that are underway in Pennsylvania and by the federal government, too, to make sure that folks are aware of pathways that you can suggest. Let me just say as a background for this, the marketplace, the Affordable Care Act was supposed to, and at some point will, make health insurance applications easier. We know there are problems with the website right now. It was hard to create the website in terms of all the databases that the system needs to work with. Let me give you an example. We have in the country and in the Commonwealth, lots of publicly administered and publicly operated programs. We have Medicaid in different levels of Medicaid. We have CHIP, Children's Health Insurance Program. We have different levels of private health insurance options. And when you're a consumer, you may at times say, okay, I want to apply, but I'm going to apply for Medicaid, or I'm going to apply for CHIP, or I'm going to apply for private health insurance. The ACA says, we don't necessarily want you to decide what coverage you want. we just want you to tell us who you are. We'll verify that. We want you to tell us and estimate your income. We'll verify that. And then we will tell you what, based on our calculations with different databases, what coverage opportunities are available for you. And the first thing that the marketplace is supposed to do is figure out whether the applicant is eligible for either Medicaid or CHIP. And if you're either eligible for one of those two programs, then you can't really go any further in the marketplace. You can't get a premium tax credit. You can't go on because you can't pass go on that front. And what the marketplace is supposed to do is say, we believe you're eligible for Medicaid or your child is eligible for CHIP, and we're taking that application and sending it to the state agency that administers that program. That's how it's supposed to work. Unfortunately, with all the problems that are happening right now, the state databases and the federal databases aren't really talking with one another. When I say that, I mean that the IRA database and isn't really able to connect with the federal marketplace. So there's some problems with verifying that income. So the challenges that are available, and that's through the website, but there are some back-end solutions that folks can use. So I want to advance to the next slide, Chris, if you could. And so in applying for the health insurance marketplace, obviously there are challenges with the website, but the phone is working, and it's working at 3 in the morning and 4 in the morning. Folks can use a paper application to apply. And there's in-person assistance for folks that need that have some difficulty. And I'll show you a bit later on the contact information for those navigators. The open enrollment is still has not changed. It's from October 1st until March 31st of 2014, and then the open enrollment starts to shift in subsequent years. But again, those are people can use the marketplace and the website, but there are some challenges as we've heard. But let me advance to the next slide to give folks an opportunity about if you know that a person is eligible for Medicaid or CHIP and you want to get that determination made as soon as possible, the route that is best available over the next couple months is to apply through the state. You don't have to go just through the federal marketplace. The ACA requires the state to come up with an application process that's easier and simpler as well, and the state's done that. And the reports are the state pathways are working very well. We have an online system called Compass, which can be accessed through the Department of Public Welfare's website. That's moving along pretty well. You can apply by phone, and the numbers on your screen, for folks that don't have a screen up, it's 866-550-4355 if you're applying for Medicaid. If it's CHIP, it's 800-986-5437. That's for the CHIP side. You can apply for those programs, and the phone numbers are available. I'm not sure if it's 24/7 the way the marketplace is working, but they're available and the wait times are very small. You can also apply through a paper application that's available on websites as well. And folks can walk into any county assistance office that's available and apply. Now, these ultimately you can apply when things work out a little bit better. If somebody wants to apply for the marketplace through the county assistance office may, will go ahead and say, sure, we'll take that. And if you're not eligible for Medicaid or CHIP, we'll send that over to the marketplace. But right now, those pathways aren't working too well. Those applications are being made, but they're kind of being held in abeyance on both sides. If somebody that the marketplace is applied to and the marketplace says you're making a low enough income and you're a child or you're a disabled person, the federal marketplace isn't able to send that application over to the state because of some of the website problems. And the same thing, if somebody's applying for health insurance through the county assistance office or through Compass and their income is too high to qualify for Medicaid or CHIP, the state is holding on to that application. They're not able to send it over to the marketplace because of some of the communication problems. So those are getting worked out. They will be worked out. But those are some of the difficulties. And again, for folks that are that need health insurance now, specifically Medicaid or CHIP, the workarounds are apply through the state through some of the ways that I've described. Compass, by phone, by paper, the turnaround times will be much faster than by going through the marketplace. Last piece is the Pennsylvania Navigators. And again, for folks that need some additional assistance, there are a total of 4 Pennsylvania Navigators. The slide that's in front of you has some of those, the descriptions. I'm not going to run through all the numbers and the websites, but keep this in mind. And they're connecting with each other. So if one can't help you, another can probably give you some resources. So I think that's where we are at. You've heard quite a bit, but I'll turn this back over to Sharon and Chris.
Okay, this is Chris. Thank you, Laval. Thank you, Erin, for great presentations. I want to just note, especially with regard to the last couple slides, there was a lot of good information there. We will post, as I said, a video of this webinar, but we will also post the PowerPoint presentation. So if you were feverishly trying to scribble down some of those phone numbers and websites, don't worry, we'll make that available to you on our website a little bit later today. And you can always find these resources at our webinar page, which is pennbpc.org/webinars. Pretty easy. So just go to that page and you'll be able to link to this PowerPoint presentation, to other resources about Healthy PA and about the exchanges, the insurance marketplaces. So at this point, we have questions. We have time for some questions. I see that we did get a few written questions, so I'm going to read them. First question comes from Bill Dinwiddie. He asks, will the governor's plan continue to limit eligibility only to people who are poor, or will his plan open medical assistance to people based solely on income?
So I'll answer that. The governor's plan is a two-part. I want to change the Medicaid system, and assuming I get what I want from the ways that I was describing before, I'll expand Medicaid to 133% of poverty the way it's supposed to be as mandated by the ACA, but the Supreme Court gave states that option. So while the governor announced I'd like to do it, he'd like to do it in his way. And if he doesn't get his way, it's not clear whether the governor is willing to participate in the Medicaid expansion.
Okay. And just a reminder to folks, you can submit written questions through the control panel on your screen or click on the hand with the up arrow to raise your hand, and we will unmute you and give you a chance to ask your question verbally. We have another question from Brian Gilmore. He asks, are there any effective screening tools out there that can quickly and fairly accurately screen someone as eligible for Medicaid or CHIP versus a QHP through the marketplace? The tool on Compass does not seem to provide accurate results at this time.
Yeah, that's a pretty interesting question. There aren't any PA-specific programs, but I think that there are some subsidy calculators that may have a Medicaid algorithm built in that work. But generally, the answer is no. There's not something that's PA-specific. But let me point out that the Kaiser Family Foundation has a subsidy calculator. Enroll America also has something of a subsidy calculator, and the AARP, the Americans, I'm sorry, I always forget what that acronym is, of retired persons, AARP, also just released a subsidy calculator as well. The challenge with all those, though, I think, Brian, will be you're saying, well, yeah, Laval, those are fine for subsidies, but they don't necessarily give me a sense as to whether I'm in the Medicaid population or not. And those are the limitations that will come up on that.
Okay. Again, feel free to submit questions written or to raise your hand. I'm going to exercise my prerogative as a question moderator to ask a question of Erin. Aaron, your email address is on the screen right now, but anybody who heard your presentation and might want to engage with the Cover the Commonwealth campaign, you know, is there a place where they can go for resources, a website? Should they email you? How can they get in touch?
Yes, absolutely. Great question. So there's lots of resources on the coalition's website, which is www.coverthecommonwealth.org. And to get involved, just please give me a call, and I'll give my cell phone number, which is 412-512-9225. Again, it's 412-512-9225. And on our website, which is pahealthaccess.org, you see it on the screen, we link to both the Cover the Commonwealth website. We have lots of information on Medicaid expansion and actions that folks can take, and then our contact information for myself, for Athena, who's our advocacy director, and Antoinette, who's our executive director, and they're both based in Eastern PA, and I'm here in Western PA.
Great. Thank you, Aaron. I don't have any more questions coming through. So at this point, I will pass the mic, if you will, back to Sharon to wrap things up.
Terrific. Thanks very much, Chris. And I want to thank everyone who is on the call today, and particularly to thank Laval Miller-Wilson and Aaron Neinhauser, who gave really excellent presentations. A few things in terms of resources and next steps. We, as Chris mentioned, we will have all of the documents from today's webinar on our website. In addition, we are gathering all various resources about responses to Healthy Pennsylvania. You'll find organizations' comments on the proposal are there, and as we get more details, once the 1115 waiver is available, if you're looking for that, we'll post all of that and other people's comments about it on our website so you can see what people are saying. I want to now tell you a little bit about the next set of webinars that are going to be coming up for the Pennsylvania Budget and Policy Center. As you know, we work on a broad range of issues, so we are covering the gamut over the next month or so. Our next webinar is on Friday, November 15th, and we will talk a little bit about what's happening in the Marcellus Shale. Many of you know that Pennsylvania has been a state where there's been a lot of drilling activity in the Marcellus Shale, and due to a variety of factors, including the significant decline in natural gas prices, there's been a slowdown in the number of jobs and activity there. We're going to talk a little bit about that and what it means for Pennsylvania. We've also been monitoring what's happening in Harrisburg with respect to school funding plans and property taxes, and we've been very worried about a plan that would eliminate all school property taxes and not replace the funds adequately. Our first webinar, which you can find on our website, talked a little bit about that plan. We had Mark Ryan from the Independent Fiscal Office, and the next webinar will talk about how can you do property tax relief in areas where individuals are having a hard time paying their property taxes. What are some options that will address that problem without really making significant damaging changes to the school funding system here in Pennsylvania? And then we will take on the issue of education and where we ought to be going in December and talk a little bit about what's going to be happening next year with respect to public education, the problems that we're seeing in Pennsylvania this year, as in the past few years, with respect to services available to kids, and what are some of the solutions to getting public education back on track in Pennsylvania. So you can go to our website, you can register for any of the webinars. We will send out lots of information to you, and we'll do a whole new set of webinars in next year, and particularly as we get set for the state budget debate. So I want to thank you again and thank our guests, and have a great afternoon, and we'll see you in a couple of weeks.